How's it been, you guys? You guys are the mighty who withstood the Voto Latino regiment. I'm really impressed. Give yourselves a round of applause. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the San Jose University, State University, and the San Jose State Student Association, because the reason that we are here is because of their hard effort, and they cut us a bargain. So thank you so much, you guys, for opening up on a Saturday, and for the staff that has made sure that everything comes clearly. And I'm not supposed to be holding this?
Because I have my own mic.
Okay, thank you. Is it working?
Yeah.
Wonderful. I want to welcome everybody today to the closing plenary of the Voto Latino Power Summit. This is our last stop in a four-city tour. We started off in New York City. We went to Miami, San Antonio, and I think very tellingly we ended up in San Jose, because we use it under the auspices of it's the tech hub of the world, but in reality it's my hometown.
Yeah,
it's my backyard. So we're very proud to be here, and the enthusiasm and the response that we've been receiving from your participation has been incredible. I don't know if you've had a chance to follow Twitter, but you guys are all abuzz. So you guys are making noise in San Jose. And very appropriately, this last closing plenary, we're going to talk about the importance of the next generation workforce. And that next generation is sitting in this room with us. And I want to introduce the fellow panelists and take the next 45 minutes to take a deep dive on what are the issues that are preventing us from capitalizing on the talent, what are our opportunities, and last but not least, what is it that we can do so that we can work continuously together to promote change. To the right of me, in my immediate right, is Connie Yowell. She is the Director of Programs of MacArthur, and I can't sing her praises enough. She's the only person that has ever called me and said, we want to fund you. But
I know great work.
No, but I think it's 10 years ago, Connie was curious to see how do you engage Latino millennials and millennials at large using education. How do you reimagine education? How do you take it from a 20th century model to a 21st century model? How do you recognize that the people sitting in this room are constantly learning outside of the classroom? How do you make it count? So the badges that you've been receiving today has been the brainchild of Connie, because she recognizes that every time you do an internship or a fellowship, that life experience, that work experience should carry beyond those four walls, and that the classroom of the 21st century is changing. So thank you so much for your vision. Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for making the Power Summit possible, Connie.
Oh, thank you for doing amazing work. Thank you all for being here.
The next person that I'm excited to introduce is Peter Moore. How many people like EA Sports? Come on! How many people like EA Sports?
People!
I was about to leave.
Try not to nerd out.
FIFA!
There you go.
I think they're very, not only are they very excited, but they're like, oh my gosh, he's in the room. I want to thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
I want to thank you also because he just came from Sweden last night, so I think the fact that he's still standing is not only amazing, but I think it's a testament to the dedication that he has on this topic and the ability and opportunities that we can start cultivating talent to work more closely together. So thank
exactly.
you much.
My
and
pleasure.
Thank you for your family. You brought your family. Thank you so much for bringing your wife and daughter
right
here.
There.
Woohoo! And more importantly, we'd like to be able to, at the very end, have questions and answers, and hopefully we'll be able to talk about how do we get more male and female folks into the space. Someone that does not need introduction is my partner in crime, the fabulous Rosario Dawson. Folks know her for her on-screen talent, but I think it's your dedication to the community and transforming lives that everybody is going to leave knowing you. She has an incredible vision where she works very closely with the Lower East Side Girls Club. She does local work, recognizing that you need to empower yourself locally. Voto Latino is her national organization, and then she also sits on the board of V-Day, recognizing that impact can be international. She is one of the folks that participated in 1 Billion Rising. So February 14th, you guys, is when women and their partners stand together in strength and recognize that you end domestic violence by conversation, but that it's not a woman issue, but it's a partner issue. So thank you for all the work that you do. And most recently, she launched a clothing line, so that's what. I always try to keep up. But I would like to start the conversation with a couple of things, a couple of questions. But more importantly, it's like, let's start with the basics. Why are we here tonight? Why are we having this conversation? It's very open-ended.
Very open-ended.
So we were walking, and I asked a question. I asked her a question. Yeah. She's like, "So what do you mean by that, Connie? You want me to drill it down?" No, but I think it's for a lot of young people, especially here in Silicon Valley. We recently found out that we're not hiring the talent of Latino and African Americans that we can. And it turns out that American universities are actually turning them out twice as times the number than are getting hired. So how do we change that equation? What is it that we need to do?
Let me back up and answer the first part of your question in terms of why are we here. Mm-hmm. There are a bunch of different ways to answer that. From my lens, I'll say it in a particular way, which is to say we're in a really important moment in time. Which is, there are moments when massive change happens, and there are moments when things are kind of static and not a lot of change is happening. When the printing press came out, that was a time of massive change. Prior to the printing press, there were scribes who were actually writing down knowledge, and there was not a real sharing of information. The printing press massively transformed the distribution of knowledge and information. We are in a moment of massive transformation and change because of our technological tools and because of globalization. The two are connected. What that means is that in this window, it's not going to last forever. It's a window of time of change. And that means that it is a time when things are being designed and transformed. And the folks who really have the skills and capacity to design and transform things have an enormous amount of power in terms of how we all experience the world. So I don't know if you notice, but almost everything you do, how you communicate with your friends, how you move from point A to B, whether it's in your car or whether you're flying or whether you're riding a bike, many of you today spent half of your time with your sort of looking like this and going like this.
Or like this.
In terms of how you're communicating, exactly.
But the good news is that if it's really quiet and their heads down and conferences, it's because they're tweeting, right, guys?
Yeah. How you participate politically now is very much determined by the technology that is afforded to you. It is your generation that will really be responsible for the design of all of these tools. It is your generation for whom this is the window. And it is your generation that will ultimately have you, it's the power in your hands to design these tools and to really begin to think about how you want to shape the design of this technology in effect for your community. And if you don't have those technological skills or don't understand the design of how these things are put together, then somebody else is going to be designing for your community. And so part of the reason why I'm here and why we're here is to say that the leaders of your community, the millennials, the Latino leaders within the millennial population, you guys have to be the designers for your community. It's going to determine political participation, it's going to determine how you communicate with each other, and it is how you empower yourselves and how you engage. And it's critically important that we all own the enormity of the opportunity of this moment and lean into it.
And I think what you're saying, Connie, too, is that if we don't participate as Latinos in tech, we actually leave business opportunities on the table as well. Because oftentimes we create apps and we create for needs that are present to us. Mm-hmm. And while some of them are fancy apps such as Uber, that's not really solving a local problem. But if we get you guys to start designing solutions to local problems, you can create businesses, but also address real needs as well. And so, Rosario, why do you think sometimes there are these barriers to the tech industry when it comes to the Latino community, and how can we change that? And that how can we change that is open to the panel.
Well, first of all, so excited to see all of you here. This is very exciting. And second of all, the
The reality is that you are all over-indexing on the internet, on technology. But for some reason, you're lacking behind and actually taking on those tech jobs. So that's a big problem for many reasons, right? So the average Latino worker makes $34,000 a year. The average tech person makes $77,000 a year. That's double. So imagine what that income can do for those different families in those different communities. Think about as well the fact that because Latinos over-index on using, adopting new technologies, adopting new cell phones, adopting 3D technology, all these different things, it's stupid on behalf of these actual companies to not have you coming on board and working for them, to take the advantage of the information that you know, because you're the ones working with this technology going, I wish it did this. If it only did that, it would be so great. I talk about my friends all the time. So there's clearly a need from the company side. And as you were saying earlier, there's this interesting thing, this USA Today article came out talking about how actually, because what we keep hearing, right, is that we need to do more STEM. And Latinos are not necessarily joining in math and sciences and things that they should be and could be doing. So it is a K-12 problem of how we make sure that we have more of our young people signing up into these STEM pathways. But at the same time, we've had affirmative action for a very long time. And because of affirmative action, we actually have and are turning out a lot of black and brown people who are graduating with this, the actuality of the information that they need to have and the degrees that are necessary, but the companies aren't hiring them. So what is that? You know, we have to really go and, okay, we put different universities' feet to the fire and said you need to be hiring and you need to be enrolling people of diversity. And they did that, but now the companies aren't hiring. So now we have to be on top of them. But one of the things that you can do is start networking with each other. That's the reason why we created these summits, is to encourage each other, to work with each other, to network with each other. And if someone isn't hiring you, who cares? Because you can do it on your own. That's the amazing thing about the technology that you have today, is people are creating apps, they're creating organizations, they're creating all different types of things. And we really need you to do that with the idea in mind that it's not just funny, and it's not just cute, and it's not just fun and a side thing to do, but actually maybe what you could do for your life, what you can do to transform your community. And that's really important. We need to make those asks, and we need to present that to you. Because so often when I'm working at the Lower East Side Girls Club, you have these kids, and you know, the parents are still saying the same thing, like, be a doctor, be this or that. And the kids are like, yeah, whatever, I just want to be famous, right? And that's real well and cute and good, but it's like, you always have a new pair of kicks in here, kid. Every day you have a new pair of kicks. Why don't you run the Nike division of Mexico? Why don't you take it to that? Why don't you see yourself in that way? Why not? You're not just a consumer, you're an innovator. You know, your buying power alone, the Hispanic buying power, and there's over $1 trillion in this country. We represent quite a lot. People are paying attention. They're paying attention to who you vote for, what you buy, what you promote, what you share. And it's time to understand that all of that makes you really powerful and really special. And when you start knowing that, there's no stopping you. And we are gonna continue to trumpet that horn to make sure that we're the ones being able to see the difference in all of you. And it's not gonna be the same story of like, oh, young youth, they're so apathetic, they don't care. No, it's your eyes are the innovators, you're the game changers. You're the ones that our young people are gonna be reading about, our kids are gonna be reading about in the history books. The ones that created that thing, that did that thing, that promoted that thing, that changed the face of the world. Yeah. It's not happening.
So Peter, most of us in this room see the tech industry from the consumer perspective.
Yeah.
How's sausage made?
It's not pretty, that's for sure. Now, I just want to follow up both on Connie and Rosario's point about where we are from a cultural perspective, a societal perspective. In a few months, I'll have been 60 years on this earth. Just in a few months. There's more happened. Thank you.
For just we should have known we would have brought mariachis, and that's what we usually do.
For just getting here? Yeah. There is more happened in my lifetime than maybe in the 1,000 years preceding it from a technology perspective. I can still remember being in awe of a touch-tone telephone and not having to put my finger. You're not pretending you know what that is.
I actually do, because God bless you think that I don't. The rotary,
they don't know what rotary is.
You want to confuse a millennial, put a rotary phone in front of them.
Exactly. I can still looking at in awe at a piece of paper coming out of a fax machine and going, how does that work? And we fast forward where we are today, and I am honored and privileged to work for a company that has hundreds of millions of people that enjoy entertainment, for the most part via the internet, which didn't exist for the most part 30 years ago. And my message to you when I think of my company, Electronic Arts, we're about 8,500 employees around the world. Nice. We're about a $4.5 billion company. the Hispanic demographic, FIFA games, our Battlefield games, which the guys are certainly aware of, is a very important part of our business. But our challenge all the time from a bringing, we have a huge diversity program at EA, is attracting people like yourselves. Our real challenge is quite frankly, bringing women into interactive entertainment, bringing Latino and people of African-American descent into interactive entertainment, and yet these are our consumers. And it's baffling to me, and it always has been baffling to me. I'm an immigrant. I'm from Liverpool. I grew up as a working class lad. My dad was a docker, a longshoreman, who got us out of Liverpool eventually for a better life, and I lived in a pub. My granddad was a merchant sailor. So I come from humble roots, and I've been very lucky because I took what this country offered me when I came here with my wife in 1981. The puzzle for me as I sit as the chief operating officer of a multi-billion dollar entertainment company is why the people who are consumers still don't seem to grasp the opportunity that our industry provides. You talk about 77,000, most of our jobs are six-figure jobs. Mm-hmm. But, and Rosario said, it's all about science, it's all about math. We're moving towards a very analytical industry. Hundreds of millions of people play our games every month. We analyze what they do. And you are the people we need. The ridiculous thing about this valley where we're sat today is that companies here are desperate for lobbying the federal government for more H-1 visas. Do people know what H-1 visas are? Well, there are two things. You know what they are, and shame on us. If you don't know what an H-1 visa is, that's bringing a foreigner in to do the job of somebody that we have talent here. And people, I worked at Microsoft. We were bringing 40,000 people in a year from outside the United States on H-1 visas, screaming for those people to come in. Why? Because bluntly, we couldn't find the talent domestically. And it's there, and it's there for the taking. You go on our job site right now, there's probably 800 open jobs. 800 around the world, but 800 open jobs. So we have about 10% of our workforce is open at any time. We have a diversity program that actually will advantage people of color, and certainly would advantage females coming into the workforce. And yet we struggle. We go around the country, Carnegie Mellon, New York University, MIT, Stanford, even San Jose State here, looking for good people. And my message to you as an immigrant, and somebody that's been able to have the good fortune of living in America, and only became a citizen 2 years ago. That was primarily because I got harassed every time I came in with, if you got a 30-year-old green card, in the end, you're gonna get harassed and say, it's about time, and they were right. It's about time you went and got a US passport. But
you were staying at that point.
In the end, I said, okay, and then if you haven't done the paperwork, there's a reason that it will take you 30 years to get your citizenship. But from the perspective of the opportunities that I see, as again, as the chief operating officer of a publicly traded interactive entertainment company that is on the cutting edge of where technology meets entertainment, which is right in the living room. It's right on the TV screens. If anybody has got an Xbox One or a PlayStation 4 and has ever played FIFA or Battlefield or Need for Speed, you know what I'm talking about. And my message is very simple. You know, go to the classes that deliver science. Go to the classes that deliver math, because this is what this valley is looking for today. And there's plenty of work. There's plenty of work. Sorry, I'm rambling.
No, I think that's very useful. And I think it's, how do we create those opportunities? And how do we create the opportunity not only of providing the ideas, but also the access and the roadmap? I'm getting tired, my ESL's kicking in, guys. What is that word?
I couldn't think of degrees earlier.
but Connie, I called Connie last year, and I was like, you know, Connie, she's like, what would you like to do, my dad? I said, you know, it would be really cool for Voto Latino to celebrate our 10 years by going back to our roots of tech and providing an opportunity. And she's like, that's terrific, let's do a contest. And in my mind, I was like, oh, great, we're gonna do a contest. And in my mind, I was like, oh, it's gonna be like $25,000. We're like 3 months into it, and she said, no, Maria Teresa, we're talking about giving away $500,000. And I was like, what? Not only was it generous, but it was amazing, right? Talk to us about that, and talk to us why that program such as that is important.
Well, first I was pissed about the H-1 visas and really believed that there is an incredible amount of talent and ability in the Latino community that needed to be made visible. and wanted MacArthur to be supportive of the community and to allow the capacity and the talent that is in your community just to be visible. Because I think in so many respects, our society has not yet, and I think that's part of the issue with the education system, does not help to make visible all the skills and capacities that your community and that you as, when your students in education and more broadly already have and already bring into the classroom. And so part of what we're after is really trying to create opportunities for Latino youth to show, to make visible, and to engage the skills and capacities that you already have and to level those up. And we really want more than anything the Latino community to be the makers and creators of the solutions that are most important for your own community. And in doing that, to be able to build the skills and capacities that you're gonna need for the jobs that Peter was talking about. And so that's part of what that grant was about, and hopefully what the competition is enabling Voto Latino to be able to do with such extraordinary folks.
Well, and I think just some background a little bit on Connie. The reason Connie works so hard in the Latino community is that you did your thesis on the Latino community. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? And then I'd like to lead into how one career path doesn't define you for the rest of your life.
Yeah, so. Yeah. So part of the work that I've done, my background is in developmental psychology, and I will also say that I grew up in a very small farm town in Michigan, and I am the first person in my family to go to college. And one of the things that I spent 8 years of my life on the west side of Chicago with Latino youth, trying to understand sort of expectations for the future, aspirations for the future, and how those expectations and aspirations connect to school, connect to understandings of career and opportunity. And one of the things that became so immediately apparent to me in doing all of this research was the extraordinary disconnect between the kinds of skills and capacities that those youth were bringing into the school and the school's inability to notice them, to reward them, to connect them then to what was expected in the classroom. And so many of the students just sat silent and quiet in the classroom while the teacher then talked at them, instead of actually engaging them in things that were of interest to them and might be important to them. And part of what we know about education and learning is that the best learning happens when it connects what's of interest and of passion to you as the learner, connects you to your culture, and then connects you to opportunities in the real world. And so often, our classrooms don't do that. And so part of the work that we've been doing with badges is to try to create the opportunity for folks to make visible pathways to the future. So that, and we're just experimenting, and I appreciate all of you engaging with us in these badges and with these experiments, but you're gonna see that as you start collecting your badges, that one badge connects to another badge. So that as you have experiences, you'll start understanding the badges will make visible to you the next thing that you wanna do in order to get better at something. So these networks that we're talking about, often for those of us who haven't been to college, it's kind of invisible. Like, what do I do next? How do I figure out how to get good at something? Who do I turn to? How do I find a mentor? How do we access those kind of white middle class power networks that so many other folks have when their parents can tell them what to do because their parents actually went to college and had access to all of those networks? With the internet and with the networks that are available on the web, we're gonna try to connect those with this light technology of badges. And so that's part of why we've opened up this opportunity for you to be the first ones to really experiment with them and to join us in this work.
So thank you for being the guinea pigs, not knowing. But I want you, Connie, I want you to know how you're among a good group. How many folks are the first folks in your family to go to college? Raise your hand, right?
It's hard, isn't it?
Powerful.
Yeah, congratulations. Now here's the thing. You have to finish.
Yes.
You have to finish. Promise me you're gonna finish. It really matters for employability, for salary, for everything. It really matters. There's an extraordinary sort of curve about being in college for 2 years and then not finishing. It really matters. You have to finish. Vitally important. And what's amazing, too, about the whole networking thing, which was really great, is Avery, who works with us at Voto Latino, had found this really great quote from Hector Barreto Sr., who actually founded the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. And he said, if you want to get to Smith, but you have no connections to Smith, Sanchez to Sanchez it. Figure out the person who is working with Smith already and collaborate with that person. So right here, you have a network among yourselves. So stay connected with each other, because maybe you're not interning for that group or you're not working for that group, but he or she is. And if you stay connected to that person, you can take that connection and maybe build on it. And that's what the networking part of all of this is really important. And what we're doing with these different summits that are happening in city to city, why do that and we could just fly people in or whatever? No, because it's important to go all around the nation so that the connecting that you're doing here right now also connects you to all of those other people. And in the years to come, you're gonna have a network that is national and international, because we have people coming in from all around the world to speak to you as well. And that's gonna give you the advantage that maybe you're missing because your parents didn't go to college and give you those benefits that nepotism helps so many other people get.
I can't tell you how important this opportunity is, and being connected to Voto Latino and the networks are just, it's huge.
No, and I think that it's, and it's been fun. I think that the folks that come in really care about making sure that we are empowering each other and moving forward. And I think that what makes our life experience unique is that each of us have had multiple jobs. And I want to talk to you a little bit about that, Peter. The fact that you have worked from, you went to Reebok, to Sega, to Microsoft, and now you're at EA. How can you tell someone that maybe has had, you know, one or two careers under their belt, that tech is still for them, and that there is opportunity there?
So one thing I've learned, being probably the oldest person in this room, about life.
That's okay. I went out to dinner last night, and the waiter kindly told me that I was the oldest person at the table.
Did you get a tip?
I was like, I'm aware.
But it's life's journeys. I mean, the constant for me has been the foundation of a good education. I was very lucky. Very lucky when I was 11 years of age, and this is going to sound brutal to everybody, in Britain in the 60s, tough times, you would set a national exam at 11, called the 11 plus. If you passed, you were deemed then capable of going on to further education. Again, at 11 years of age. If you failed, you were sent to a separate school, in those days called a secondary modern school, where you were put on a path to a trade, bricklaying or a plumber, and it was a brutal system. It was elitist. And I was fortunate enough, and it wasn't through any academia or studying that I remember, I was fortunate enough to pass my 11 plus. And that put me on the path towards what I am that I sit here today. Along that way, as Maria Teresa says, I have taken some journeys, and I have never in my life, and this is going to sound horrific, been in a business class ever, ever. I'm a PE teacher by trade that was fortunate enough to be a pretty good soccer player, to be able to come over to America, to coach, kick a ball around in the Midwest, come full-time to run a soccer school in Long Beach, realized that that wasn't gonna work out, got a job as a shoe salesman, carrying shoes in the back of my Toyota Camry for a soccer shoe company, worked my way up there, selling primarily in East LA, eating menudo for breakfast to make that sale in Baldwin High School. My number one account was Casa Prieto in Baldwin Heights there, and I learned enough Spanish to sell shoes, and literally would have menudo for breakfast, and I got used to it in the end, but it was just, for a lad from Liverpool, it was tough, but moved on, could kick a ball around, became president. That was a company called Patrick, which is a French company, got spotted by Reebok, dragged my poor family to New England winters, ran global sports for Reebok throughout the 90s, took on Nike in those days. But then in my mid-40s, decided that I needed a career change. We were getting pummeled by the powerhouse that was Nike, and we moved back to the West Coast to work for Sega. Hmm. And I launched the Sega Dreamcast, which some of the older guys will remember in the audience. Tough times if the PlayStation 2 was coming your way, but we got through, and Sega's still around. But then, as life goes along, you attract somebody's attention, you network. We were a great partner of a little company called Microsoft that was about to launch a box called the Xbox. And I was recruited to go to Seattle, again with my family, kicking and screaming about the weather there as well, to launch the Xbox business. And had a fabulous time at Microsoft and learned so much about what great companies do. And we can talk about Microsoft all night. But again, with no business background, with no technical degree, but on the basis of a decent education, of work ethic, the ability for me to evolve as a human being. I went from a guy selling shoes in Southern California in East LA to Mexican, El Salvadoran, Venezuelan, Colombian stores down there to, as I sit here today, as the chief operating officer of a $4 billion company. The core platform that is me, a little bit of personality from being from Liverpool, a little bit of personality of growing up in a pub, certainly the discipline of being a PE teacher and having to make 40 kids every 45 minutes do something they didn't want to do. We all loved PE, didn't we? And then grasping the opportunity that was America. Bernice, my wife, and I we gave everything up, came here with about $4,000, arrived in Long Beach, lived in a trailer with no running water, God bless my wife, in Long Beach Veterans Stadium for a year and a half, and eventually just clawed my way through. And there is nothing that I have done that you can't do. Because if you've never lived outside of America, you don't realize how lucky we are. For all the tough times that we go through in this country, go somewhere else and go see what everybody else goes through. The opportunity here is endless. And so my message there and the lessons I've learned, good solid education, tremendous work ethic, grasping everything that America has to offer. Never think because you're gonna get a degree in something, that's where you're gonna end up. I'm a shoe dog that somehow became a little bit of a marketer. And I went from Reebok to Sega because I understood how to market to young males, quite frankly. Learned enough about technology to fake it in interviews at times. Like anybody else, you become a sponge. And you sit around smart people all day, which I'm fortunate enough to do. They don't let me touch any of the code or anything to do with it. But you just have got to absorb it. The osmotic effect of being around smart people, the greatest 4.5 years of my life has been at Microsoft for that, where just brainiacs walking around. It was incredible. I mean, it was a company was going through tough times, if you followed Microsoft during that year, where the federal government wanted to split them up because of the monopolies. But boy, what an experience for me. I was always the dumbest person in the room, but I came out of that a little smarter every time. And that's an attitude you've got to have. I mean, it's just pretty simple.
But I think that your story is exciting because we constantly talk about jobs in tech and we are always thinking of coders. Mm-hmm. But there's so many other pieces of the puzzle that make a company successful. Can you talk a little bit about
that? Yeah, I mean, of the people that actually make the games, it's probably less than half of our employees. Mm-hmm. We need marketers, certainly analysts. We have moved away from, if you're involved in marketing or you're in school doing marketing, this used to be, and when I was a marketer, let's make a big TV campaign. At Reebok it was, let's go get Shaq, let's go get Sean Kemp, let's go get Nick Van Exel. These names mean nothing to you, maybe Shaq, but and let's go do TV commercials. And then let's call Foot Locker 2 months later to see if we sold any more shoes as a result of these TV commercials. As I sit here today, I know when I go in on Monday into the office in Redwood Shores, just up off of 101, we will have our data analysts analyzing our marketing spend every 30 minutes, going online, pushing our digital spend. It's called PBM, performance-based marketing. We turn it on and off depending on the results we're getting every 60 minutes. We push millions of dollars into avenues, looking at the lifetime value, the LTV of a customer, and we make those calls literally minute by minute. But they are young people. These are the digital natives. Mm-hmm. They don't let people anywhere close to my age get near any of this stuff. But we give these 20-somethings $10, $15 million to spend as they see fit because they're smart, they're analytical, they're results-driven, and the fact that the internet technology today can measure this stuff, what we call ROI, the return on our investment. Again, used to be monthly or quarterly. It's minute by minute. But you need to know data, you need to analyze data, and again, it goes back to what we talked about at the outset of this panel, math and science. Because if you don't have those in today's world, maybe you can get by, but I just don't see the success path. Doesn't matter whether you're marketing or whether you're writing code or whatever it is, the core elements of being able to analyze what's going on is key, and that's what we look for. But again, you don't have to have a computer science degree to work electronic arts.
Well, Well, and I think, let's let everyone in on a little secret. Harvard has been doing a lot of studies on bilingual, bicultural kids. And for a long time, you find that bilingual kids, their speech, it takes them a while to talk. But it turns out it's because their brain is functioning and their synapses are actually moving at speeds of light that they hadn't seen in the way that they're connecting words, language. And when they test them 4 or 5 years after with folks that are just monolingual, they're actually more highly analytical because of the dual language. Mm-hmm. But we're not capitalizing that at schools. And oftentimes teachers, because the kid may not be speaking at the same level, actually think that they're slow, but in reality is that their brain is just adapting faster to learning two languages at the same time. So so you guys are already, for those who are bilingual, how many are bilingual in this? Huh?
Nice.
You guys are already on a path to analysis, but you just don't know it. So learn how to tap into that.
I love that. It reminds me of this quote my grandmother used to say all the time, coming from Puerto Rico. She'd say, you know, I may speak with an accent, but I don't think with an accent. That's very key.
So Rosario, 10 years ago, with Voto Latino, we started using a lot of technology from its onset. How do you think that technology, one, would be as relevant as it is today, and two, that it would have made Voto Latino go on to this path?
You know, it's funny, I mean, I grew up, I love sci-fi, so, you know, the second anything technology showed up, it was like, yes, this is for us, it's gonna be great. You know, and a lot of our utilization of technology in the beginning with Voto Latino was just because it was cost effective. You know, we didn't have offices, we didn't have all this money to throw around and all this kind of stuff, so we went where the technology was, and it saved us money and it gave us access. We were the first ones to use texting to do voter registration in 2006. You know, we've been the first to do so many different things. It's been amazing. You know, thank you so much. MacArthur Foundation gave us $500,000 to give to young people who don't necessarily have to know how to do code or even be a college graduate, but just to have a really great idea so that we can do things again to just like pump innovation into our communities. It's very exciting. And that's the thing that's surprising to me. Not that the technology kept growing because you expected it, you hoped for it. I dreamed about it. I was like, I'm still waiting for my hoverboard. I can't believe it. I'm so mad. And you know, there's a lot of things in Star Trek that if suddenly exist, I probably won't ever leave my room, because why, if you have a holodeck, I don't see the reason of leaving your house. But anyway, the thing that's really surprised me actually was the fact that we were starting this organization to reach out to young Latinos, and that the people that we were reaching out to, utilizing the technology that we had at the moment, were actually gonna over-index on the usage of that technology. That's the thing that really surprised me, that of all the demographics of people that we were working with, actually you were the ones who were the first ones to adopt new technologies and really utilize it. So it was perfect that we were using technology to reach out to you, because you were the first ones listening on those devices. So that was really remarkable. And so that's the thing that's been really surprising, is to see how far we're able to take it. It was in 2006 when young people were texting each other that you all mobilized and walked out of your classrooms for immigration reform. And to watching dreamers who have no political voice technically, able to organize themselves and make the president have to listen to them and have to say, no, I am not the deporter in chief, because they were able to make their voices heard on that level. Like, that's the thing that's just been so remarkable and so exciting. And so I'm looking forward to seeing now how you are going to talk to us. How are you gonna reach out to us? Because we're listening. We're here to amplify your voices. And so we listen to you when you're talking about education's important to you, gun control's important to you, immigration reform's important to you, all the different things. But soon you're gonna just be like embedding it into our brains. You're gonna be like, you're gonna be coming over and hacking our computers and just putting out messages and just doing it. Like it's because
good,
of the volunteer
messages, right, guys?
Yeah, good messages. You know, but it's amazing to see that the volunteers and the people that we're working with only make our organization that much better. Because you're using technology not as a crutch, but as a tool. And that's what we are gonna continue to need to do in order to take things to the next level.
That's powerful. Oh, that's powerful.
But I love that. I love that you guys are not just consumers, that you're not just, you know, you're not just playing with this, but your spending power, your brain power, everything that you have, especially with Voto Latino that we talk about the immigrant background, that's another vital key component that you have that you bring to the conversation that is necessary in our leadership and politics and in companies and all of that. Why? Because you're connected to families outside of this country. You have a perspective that actually comes from all different places around the world through your own family line. And so you know the issues. If you're first or second or third or fourth or fifth generation, or your family's been here forever, you still have a connection outside of it just by the merit of being Latino, just by the merit of having a Spanish language that maybe you don't necessarily speak, but you identify with, because that's who you identify culturally with, that opens you up to Spain all of a sudden, and Central America and South America, in a different way than it does for other people. There's a way and a landscape that you connect yourself around the planet that's vitally important to then bringing what those thoughts are that you've just always had over the years. How do you inject that then into the different processes and things that we need to are concerned with now? Because you're bringing a lot more depth and weight to it just by the merit of being you into every single conversation you go into, and we need to tap into that.
Absolutely, and I think what you're saying too is that oftentimes people keep talking about India and China eating us for lunch because they have a billion person marketplace. But the Latino community in the U.S. is the second largest Spanish-speaking country in the world, second largest. When you connect our biculturalism and our language and you open up the Americas, that's close to a billion-person marketplace. So I actually think that companies are leaving money on the table, but not making sure that we're preparing the next generation of our workforce to capitalize on inherent skills that they already have. Mm-hmm. And with that, Connie, why is it important to have young people in tech? Why is it important for them to not only improve their skills, but to start exploring this possibility when we're talking for an economy of the next 10, 15, 20 years?
In part, it's because of all the things that we've already said, because it's where the majority of the jobs are going to be for the next 10 or 20 years, because it's where all of the design is going to be happening in terms of what our world is going to be looking like, and we want you guys to be designing it. And because it's where you're going to have the opportunities for empowerment and expression. And so the more that you have those kinds of skills and capacities, the more you have control of the dollars that are going into that industry, the more you're going to be able to have a say around whether it's governance or politics or economics, the more you're going to be able to have control over that. And so it's just absolutely critical that that's a big part of where you as millennials are really thinking about where you want to take your future.
And we really, I cannot overemphasize how much we need your voices.
Yeah.
You are the most diverse generation we've ever seen. You are the most accepting, not tolerant, accepting generation we've ever seen. The things that you care about, the things that you do not care about, that our forefathers did, like making someone of color be considered less than a human being legally, or having women not have no right to vote, or people who love each other of the same sex not being of value. That's just not the stuff that you're concerned about. What you're concerned about is getting a job. You're concerned about inheriting trillions of dollars of debt because of those same people who said these are the things to concentrate on. You're like, no, clearly they weren't, because now you've made it really hard for us. You know, that's the thing that we really need, your voices coming in and changing the game, because when you come up and you show up, 33% of the Latin available vote is young people. And unfortunately, young people across the board in every demographic aren't showing up in the numbers that they could. But if you did, we don't have to wait another 12 years. We don't have to wait. Right now, we can start to see the critical changes, because you have the numbers and the power right now to do it. And that's what we really need. That's what we're excited about. And I'm so excited that you care about it too, because you're here. I could not be more grateful. When we started this organization 10 years ago, we were calling people who were not calling us back. But you heard that call, and you're here. And thank you for it. We will continue to be here for you.
And Peter, to that, what's a word of wisdom? If you could have told yourself something, some advice 10 years ago or 15 years ago, that you wish that someone had told you, how would you?
I think what we all need to understand about the world in which we live in, and Rosario and Connie have said this well, is that the pace of change. We're either pioneers or settlers in America. It's pretty simple. Now, the pioneers do get the arrows at times, but boy, if you're a pioneer and you win, and where we sit within 30 miles of this auditorium, some of those pioneering work that has not only changed America, has changed the world, has been done. We are so close to Apple and Cisco and Intel and Facebook and Oracle, all on 101 here. there's a thing that we in technology adhere to, and it's a thing called Moore's Law. Nothing to do with me, but a guy called Gordon Moore. Did anybody ever heard of Moore's Law? Basically says that the power of computing doubles every 18 months. You wouldn't have smartphones, you wouldn't have video game consoles, you wouldn't have smart TVs, you wouldn't have the power of the internet, you'd still be listening. Does anybody remember dial-up? Yeah, see, barely. Yeah. Waiting for that modem to connect, and then your mom knocks you off the line because she wants to use the phone. This is what we live in today. This, and you need to understand that Moore's Law is alive and well. 18 months from now, we're going to be consuming things that we never dreamt of. But my message to you is don't be a consumer, be a creator. Be on the front end of it. Be a pioneer, not a settler. It's fun being a settler in the end because the pioneers have come through. But this area was here, it was actually built by the railroad barons, the Stanfords, the Leland Stanfords of this world, the people that laid tracks west and created, otherwise California kind of wouldn't be around without railroads. And it sounds all very primitive and analog, but that was technology in those days. It went from wagon trains to actual real trains. And we're in a similar situation. Rosario may not get a hoverboard for a while, but there is stuff going on right now, right here. Who knows what Oculus Rift is? Yeah, we all know what Oculus Rift is. That alone, which started off as a video game virtual reality headset, as dorky a thing as you've ever seen on your head, could be the next leap forward, being developed right here, actually, in Menlo Park, and is the way we're going to interact with technology, with other human beings, with tech, and do our jobs. And VR, virtual reality, is this next. It's not quite your hoverboard or your George Jetson car that you were hoping for, but these are the massive leaps that we're seeing. Be a part of that. Don't just save up to go buy one. Be a part of that. And that's the key. Be a pioneer, not a settler.
And now I'd like to open up to questions.
Buenas tardes, first of all. Mayra Diaz, it's important that I give a shout out to Emerson Collective and College Track, who made possible my presence and made me and my colleagues' presence right here. Yes, and some of you have a connection to College Track.
Absolutely.
So thank you for that. Peter, I wanted to thank you for having said something like, even though you were not the smartest person in the classroom, every time that you went, you came out of there, you know, with more knowledge and smarter. And I feel I can relate to that, and many of us can relate to that. And I feel like that also translates in the workforce now. Many of us, you know, throughout college, we're doing our best to learn as fast as we can. And compared to many of the students in our classroom, we are way behind them. And I feel at times that's also what I find myself doing in the workforce, trying to catch up, trying to learn as much as possible. And what I want to say with that is also, like many of us low-income, first-generation Latinos, undocumented, we're going through a lot. When we're in college, it's not just about college for us. It's not just about school for us. And you all know that, right? We're experiencing with a lot of violence in our homes, in our communities. There's so many things that distract us, but we're trying to make it through college. Some of us will not graduate with a 4.0. Some of us will graduate with an under 3.0 GPA. And so, Rosario, thank you for inviting us, right, to talk to you. And I think my request is, or my ask is, give opportunity to those that may graduate with a less than a 3.0 GPA. Mm-hmm. Give an opportunity to those that may not be able to graduate college for different reasons. Give an opportunity to those that may not make it to college, because we don't want to continue separating Latinos, because we're gaining an education. It's not in the just in the classroom that we're gaining this education. It's in our communities, in our homes that we're gaining an education. And I think just one of the things that we're not able to do is put words to all the experiences that we have, right? And some of us are learning that grammar, that language in schools. But give opportunity to everybody. I think that definitely if we're not coming in with the best GPA, with the best grades or with the best knowledge, I can tell you that every day that I go to work in San Mateo County, working for the county, it's like, si se puede, I can learn today, I'm gonna learn again tomorrow, and every day is coming with that mentality that we can learn and that we can create change. And so I thank you for this opportunity to be inspired and re-energized that we can promote change, we can create change, and definitely, I repeat your words together, we can. Gracias.
add to that again, that's the reason why we're doing these badges, because we recognize people aren't learning traditionally in the same situation of going to a school at a set time, at a set place, with one person saying something in the head of the classroom, and if you missed what they said, that's it. Like, you're learning online, you're learning at places like this, and you should be able to get credit for that, that you can utilize to get to push you that much further in your career options and opportunities. So I just want to say thank you so much for, you know, as you were saying before, being a guinea pig in that, because we really think that could be transformational across the nation for all of that. And know, for sure, one of the things that we were even talking about was with the Innovators Challenge. We got hundreds of applications, way more than we expected to a certain degree. And not everybody can win. You know, we have a set amount of money, and there's going to be a set amount of winners. And so we're going to have to say no to a lot of people. But we don't want to say no to them. So already we're looking into how avenues and ways that we can give all those applications so we can go, these are still really good ideas. They didn't make the final cut. But they're still really good ideas, and that passion and that commitment and that energy shouldn't be lost. It shouldn't, because too often people are told no and they stop. We need all of you to understand that failure isn't failure. It's an old idea. Every single person, an innovator who's been in front of you, had many failures, and those are the ones that really teach you. You don't learn necessarily from when you won, when you got it. Because half the time you're like, we're really sweet. So big, you got this. And you move on. And the reflection tends to not be very deep. But when you fail, you really think about it. You figure it out and you try again. And that's what we really need. So that determination, all of that is just really, really powerful.
If you're not failing, you're not trying.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And in tech, we have a saying, fail fast, fail cheap. And what that means is try lots of things. Now, when you know it's not working, stop and go try something else, but fail fast, fail cheap is the way that we do. We prototype games, we go test them within a few weeks, and if they're working and they're fun and they're engaging, we continue to invest. But again, if you're not failing, you're not trying. And if you don't learn by your failures and become a better person as a result, then you're gonna fail again. Yeah. It's the equivalent of throwing a bunch of mud against a wall. Eventually, something's going to stick. And your point on degrees is enormous. But remember, we all need to get a degree here. But it's just a key. It's the key to the door. And it turns, and you walk in, but it doesn't give you anything. I can't remember what my GPA, I have no idea. I know it wasn't very good. And nor did your employer 12 months later. That degree on your resume that gets you in there, gets you in there. After that, it's up to you. You have to finish. You have to graduate, but that's the rest of your life is about your performance and your work ethic and your ability to evolve as technology evolves. And that's the key. So don't get hung up that you're not valedictorian or an honors degree. Just get that degree and then the rest is up to you.
And believe me, there are a lot of people out there and a lot of organizations and companies out there that are even looking specifically for those C students, for those D students. I know that with the Lower East Side Girls Club, we were out there, and a lot of the programming and things that we do specifically, the nepotism that works is actually if you're failing. That's who we're looking for. You know, they had the, what's the big massive ship on the piers or whatever. They have a really cool science program they do over the summer, and they only take C students because the A and B students almost always get that pathway up. They have traction. They'll find a great program to join. But we want the other students. Maybe you're failing for all these other reasons, but you didn't realize that you really love science. You didn't know how much you love math. Clearly, maybe you had a bad teacher, maybe your parents,
well,
something
think,
about that.
Sorry,
so let's target
also,
you right now and give you another chance
but
to discover
also,
your passion.
It's
for
recognizing
it.
That oftentimes, so if you ask a Latino parent, 98% of Latino parents say that they want their kid to go to college. 98%.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
U.S. Latino, you young people, do you want to go to college? Over 90% say that they want to go to college. Mm-hmm. Yet we have one of the highest dropout rates.
Yep.
Why? Because they drop out not to basically sit on the couch, but they drop out because they need to go work and basically make ends meet at home.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So the work that, Connie, you are doing, yep, on how do you reimagine education so that, mm-hmm, it fits the lifestyle instead of having to go work for a low-end job that isn't going to get you anywhere? How do we work with school systems, with companies, so that we reimagine so that this young person that has to have the weight of the shoulders of their family can all of a sudden work with EA as an internship, get the skills that they need, and still continue going to high school, and then prepare themselves for college? That's how we need to start working as a community, not only within the Latino community and education, but with companies and corporations, so that we can actually create the real workforce pipeline, mm-hmm, where we don't have the liberty just anymore that just say it's a simple liberal arts degree, but an actual workforce. Yeah. But oftentimes people don't talk about why young people dropped out, why they're the C student. And it's oftentimes because they have to help make ends meet. And there's nothing wrong with that, because that means you're already a hard worker and you have that work ethic. But let's actually start using that energy to create solutions that are meeting the needs that our country and our economy need. And I think that, you know, to talk to you a little bit about the badge system, the badges that you guys are receiving right now were done in conjunction with MIT Media Lab, Civic Engagement Lab, because they have done some of the best practices on how do we talk about media, how do we talk about leadership, how do we talk about development. So there's value in that, because we actually knocked on doors, thanks to Connie's help, and identified the best so that they translate something more than just saying, yes, I got X, Y, and Z, but I got it from a source that has actually studied this so that we could apply it to you, so that it could be applied to your potentially for your workforce. One more question? I think we have questions. We have time for two more questions. There's someone over there and someone over here.
Good evening, San Jose State alumni. Woo, woo. Thank you so much.
Thank you for hosting.
Years ago. I graduated years ago. But I want to say thank you for this panel. Thank you for being here. So now we're going to go home, back to our communities. What are we going to do? Be sure. Ooh. I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm passionate. I can't help it.
Good.
Be sure, young people, as we're coming up, as we're voting, we're missing the middle school kids. We're missing the high school kids who maybe next year we can invite and have in a separate room or include in, because they will be the ones who will be coming up and voting. Make sure that we're going back and we're letting them know that there's programs like Ivy League where they can go and visit the schools, that we are telling them about STEM, that we're exposing them, that there's a Latinas in STEM conference in November. Don't just stay quiet and come and vote. Show them the way. As we move up, come up. I'm hoping that we'll have a Voto Latino Summit, maybe a networking site where we can go back and say, hey, I'm looking for this volunteer to come speak at my school, or so-and-so's looking for a job, can you help me network? Because you're right, we don't have that. But we have Sanchez, we have Rodriguez, we have Frias, and we have you. And don't forget.
And we have Yowell.
And we have Yowell.
That's right.
But I want to be sure that we go back and that we help and we inspire our brothers and sisters, our cousins, our neighbors to look for STEM careers, to show them the way. And there are networks. And I charge you all to go back and do that, not only when you're voting, but showing the neighbor across the street. Mijo, are you on Hour of Code this December? You're going to learn how to program. Mijo, mija, Latinas in STEM, let's go get you plugged in. Yeah. So please, and I know that our Latino Startup Alliance is having La Tecla coming up soon, encouraging girls to learn to code. Let's work on that also.
That's
great. Nice. Ay, ahua.
Can we get... Can we ask? She didn't have a question. Por
favor. Hello, my name is Sarai Espinosa. I'm an advocate for undocumented students here in the peninsula. I created a website called Sarai.tv to try to get all the scholarships provided to undocumented students on one platform. And we actually, with my partner Teek, we entered the Innovators Challenge.
Yay!
We want to expand it. It's something very small that I started on my own, and it's still really small, but I have a really huge vision. And kind of going back to kind of what College Track was mentioning about opportunities, I really encourage you guys, and I don't know who else, like the big names out there, to be able to allow undocumented students to apply for these scholarships. Because a lot of the times, there's so many dreamers in this country that have the potential to go. And on my personal story, when I graduated from high school, I wanted to go to UCLA. They came to recruit me. But by the time it came to apply, I didn't go because I didn't afford it. And I didn't qualify for FAFSA. And all the scholarships that I applied for, they all required a Social Security. So I believe that it's time for change. I want to make that change. And if there's anybody else out there that wants to join us to make that change happen, I think that it's time that we not only show support to undocumented students, and a lot of the times we talk about as Latinos of immigration reform and immigrants, but there's no support. There's a lot of big companies that are oh yeah, Latinos and this and that, but when it comes to a scholarship that they give or a grant, you can't apply if you're not documented. And I'm then why are you all for the Latino power, yet excluding one of the largest groups of students who have this potential and identify as American, because I identify as a Mexican American. I came to the United States when I was 4. I'm now 24. I've been here for 20 years, and the system still doesn't recognize me as a citizen of the United States. So I thank all of you guys for being here, taking the time to come inspire each and every one of us. All the work that you guys do and the support that you give us, I'm very grateful. And I can't wait to get to know you guys more, work with you guys closely, and make the change that we need in our communities together.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And are you familiar with Dream US? Are you familiar with Dream US?
Yes, I'm good friends with Gabby.
Good. So Dream US basically provides, it's coming out of the Donald Graham family from Washington Post. They basically created $25 million in scholarship for Dreamers, and now they're going around the country asking corporations to match that funding so that there could actually be a track. So. And thank you for your innovation.
I love all three of y'all. Just got out to just like do shout outs and like just give love, and that's just awesome. Y'all like, we don't have any questions. We know everything. We already sat, we learned, we downloaded, we sponged, we're good.
It's okay, there's gonna be a mad rush afterwards asking for everybody's card, no worries. Everyone, thank you so much for your time. I do wanna, if the Voto Latino team, if you don't mind, if you guys can actually come up, I wanna thank them for their hard work.
Great.
This is the
last
one. Voto Latino, come on.
Team.
So you guys, Voto Latino is why are you guys going this way?
Where are you going?
No, come on. So you guys, when I say that Voto Latino is, everybody always thinks that Voto Latino is larger than we are. This Voto Latino is 12 people strong. These are the mighty Voto Latinos and our volunteers. We can't do it without them. And I want to take a special recognition. Where are we? A special recognition to someone. When we started, I said, let's do 7 power summits. And she's like, no, we could do 4. I said, let's have, traveling around the country, she brought the idea of the power summits to life. And it was an idea that started 5 years ago. And it wasn't until, Michelle, I convinced you to come on board that you said, not only are we going to be able to do it, but we're going to do it fabulously. And you have not only provided leadership, but you've inspired and taught a whole group of a next generation of Latinos. So thank you so much for your leadership.
Michelle Mingas Moore.
We all need to surround ourselves with excellence. I have to say that the people at Voto Latino, I feel like I learn from you all every single day. You guys challenge me, and we are always curious. And I think that's what you were saying earlier, the importance
Absolutely.
Of curiosity.
Yeah.
And we always are throwing things on the wall to see what sticks. And
yeah.
It's this team that makes it happen. So thank you, you guys. Everyone have a great afternoon. Thank you so much for spending your Saturday with us. Thank you again to Rosario.
Tweet often.
Yes.
Copy me, tag me, at Peter Mori. I don't have Rosario Dawson numbers, but we can do it because that's one area you guys own. You own social media. And the multiplying power of that, if you've taken a picture, if you've heard some words that are compelling and inspiring, put them out there. I've been following it all day. It's been great watching
Thank
the
you.
Twitter feed all day long. Please tag me because I want to be associated with a cool group of people.
January, Voto Latino through our social media, both Facebook and online, we've reached over 127 million people.
Wow.
And that's because you guys make it happen. You
wow.
hear the information
yep.
and you share it and
that's
share it
amazing.
And share it and make change. So thank you, you guys. And thank you, you guys, for your time.
That's fantastic.
And doesn't it look like we're really shallow at Voto Latino because everybody's so beautiful? It's just an accident, for real. It's just how it happened. It's not on purpose.